It is great to see you, and I commend you on your faithfulness to be here in this nice cold weather. It's great to see so many of you. Please take note of the things in your weekly window. This Friday is Frog Friday. It's our children's youth group. It is 1 week later than usual because of all the ordination stuff happening later today, and just because it was Martin Luther King weekend and some of our families are out of town. So this coming Friday is Frog Friday. Women, please take note. Women wine in the word it says in here is January 21st. That's wrong. It's January 28th. It's the fourth Friday. So please note that and join us. This time we're going to Grumpy Goat for dinner. If you haven't been out to Grumpy Goat, it's a lot of fun. It's cute and has great food. So the 28th of January is Women, Wine, and the Word. Please also take note of the women's retreat on the back of here. Be sure you're saving this date. Our theme is Bound Together in Love, and we are very excited to gather, as always, and have a wonderful weekend together. So put that date on your calendar and plan to be a part of that. Blessings. Oh, Dennis Hewitt, I'm holding this up because this is my note to remind me that I stuffed under my bulletin. Dennis Hewitt, will you come up and talk to us about pads? And I will tell you that we had planned to have a training on Wednesday night for pads, and then Sherry Maxson, not here today, Sherry Maxson got stuck on a train in Chicago because there were some problems, and so there were a few people who couldn't come. So we have postponed that training, and we're in the process of setting up another date. So Dennis is going to talk to us about pads.
Okay, well, first of all, Lois gave me the opportunity, tried to give me the opportunity last week. I was suffering from vertigo, and I didn't think you'd want to see me staggering up here like a drunken sailor. So I thought we'd postpone this. It was probably a good thing we did because we didn't have the training that we planned. First of all, I really wanted to thank everybody for all of your kindness over the Christmas season. We were just amazed at the numbers that we received from the Christmas Eve services. It's going to do an awful lot in this particular time when the state is not doing anything for us. So. You got it? That's better. Okay. So anyway, I just really wanted to thank everyone. It was just an amazing outpouring. The other thing is, we are in need at this time of about several nights of the month. We normally can fill 23 to 25 nights of the month with volunteer organizations, and that's about where we're at now. We could still use volunteers 6 or 7 nights of the month, and Sherry Maxson is trying to put together a group from here to come possibly one night. We are in need of both teams and individuals because we have a lot of nights where we just have individuals. And we would really, really like you to at least take a shot at it, see what you think. I promise you, you will not be disappointed, and you will feel rewarded when you leave. We are planning several... this is the time of the year when we do several training programs, so if you could see Sherry or call our office and just get more information, that would be great. We just could use some help at this point, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Dennis, and we hope that you'll take advantage of that opportunity. Just a couple of things I want to remind you of. Gentlemen, our new breakfast men's breakfast group, the BOBS, stands for Boys Out for Breakfast, is meeting this coming Tuesday at Alexander's Restaurant, 7:30 in the morning. We don't talk about anything substantive. We just eat breakfast and insult each other like guys do. And so come on out. It's a lot of fun, and we hope that you'll do that. If you're planning on coming, you please look in Weekly Window, and you'll see Tom Howard's email address in there. You need to email him and let him know that you're planning on coming, because he then lets the restaurant know how many seats to take care of. I want to say a big thank you to all of you who have contributed to the Martin Luther King Jr. food drive. I know that it will be helpful all around this area, and it's just exciting to think about what our gifts will be, how well they will do with other churches in the area and other organizations who are collecting food as well. So we're grateful of that, and thank you to the Missions and Social Concerns Committee, and Coleman Smith and Linda have done this in the past, and we're so grateful for all the work that everybody does on this. If you have been living under a rock, you would not know that we have something very special going on this afternoon, and that is at 3 o'clock we'll be having the ordination service for our own Kathy Juergens. Kathy will be beginning her work as the pastor of the Emmanuel Baptist Church. Emmanuel, boy, that's a yes. Well, that's scary to death, won't it? Man, that went through an old channel somewhere. How's your revival voice? That's right. Well, yeah, you've been hanging around with me. You could do that. The Emmanuel United Church of Christ in Sedalia, Missouri. And this afternoon, she will be ordained to the gospel ministry. If you please come on out and support Kathy. An ordination is something that doesn't happen that often. And it's a lot of pomp and pageantry. And it'll be a lot of fun. And you'll get to see Kathy serve communion for the very first time as an ordained minister today. So it's really something to be excited about. Because of the ordination service and because so many people are involved in the reception and other things, we will not be doing the way or life keys tonight at 5 o'clock, but we will pick up back up with them next week. So if you're interested in either one of those, and we hope that you are, we hope that you'll put that on your calendar. It's not too late to be a part of it. And so next Sunday, we will pick back up with that. Also, remember that next Sunday is our annual meeting. We will have this service downstairs in the Fellowship Hall, and then we will go immediately into our annual meeting at Fellowship Hall with brunch provided by the Church Council. So keep that in mind. If you have your smartphone and would be willing to check in, that would be great. Let folks know that you braved the elements to come and be a part of this today, and we're very excited about that. And if you would find the welcome book in your pew and open it up and fill out all the information that's called for and then pass it on to your neighbor so that they can do the same, that would be great. And if you're the last person on the pew, please tear it out and put it in the offering plate a little bit later on. Are there other announcements today?
There's one back there.
Oh, yes, Coleman. Okay, we need some people to help load the groceries and be going out this door. Is that correct? So just gather up here when the service is over and we'll move all the stuff out. Thank you, Coleman. Anyone else? Oh, Carl's speaking later. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He has a special slot, right? Then find somebody you haven't spoken to and tell them to keep warm. You are welcome here, no matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey. You are welcome here, no matter who you are. Come and join with us. We're united in the Church of Christ. Let's remember that guided by the Holy Spirit, the purpose of First Congregational United Church of Christ in Elgin is to seek God's truth, practice Christ's teachings, and love others unconditionally. God is still speaking. Are you listening? I invite all who are able to stand and join me in this morning's call to worship. What a beautiful thing to be called to worship. We are different people with different lives and different stories. So let us set aside our differences and focus on our shared identity in Christ. Let us worship God together. A word spoken. Wow, now that's a word spoken. Amen. A word spoken, a voice heard.
A dream revealed, a mission received.
God calls again and again.
Yet we make excuses.
It's not the right time.
I can't do that.
We don't see the whole picture.
God wouldn't want me. I'm not worthy.
Yet God calls you and me. God loves us just the way we are.
But beckons us to continue our growth into the people we are called to be.
Let us pause and listen for God's direction as we ask, God, what are you calling me to do? Thanks be to God. Thank you. Please be seated. We have been highlighting some of the folks in our church and their passions, as well as some of the mission opportunities that we have here. And we are going to hear today from our own Carl Flax. Carl?
Well, pretty high. Okay, how's that? All right. Well, I've been involved with a faith community my whole life. My mother was a Sunday school superintendent for the Community Methodist Church that we attended in Ingleside, Illinois. And throughout my life, the scripture that has influenced me the most can be found in Matthew 25, verses 35 to 40. It's something that I know many of you are familiar with. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. The righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it we saw you hungry and gave you food or thirsty or gave you something to drink? And when was it we saw you a stranger and welcomed you or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Now, these are words that over the years have caused me to be involved in several groups that this church has been involved in and still is. I was involved back in the 1970s in a group that was known as the Elgin Prison Release Ministry, and we worked to help prisoners getting out of jail to try to fit back into the Elgin community. And many a night I sat in a parking lot waiting for a second shift to be over to pick up somebody and take them home because there was no other way for them to get there. These are the same words that caused me in the early 1980s to be involved in helping our church resettle a Laotian refugee family here in Elgin, the Famachats. Some of you may remember that name. And these are the words that have encouraged me in my present capacity as vice president of the Elgin Cooperative Ministry to try to do something to solve the root causes of poverty here in Elgin. Now, the majority of you, I'm sure, know me for my involvement in our church's soup kettle. 27 years ago, I was inspired by Shirley Hokanson, who was the coordinator for the soup kitchen. And I came down to join her on Wednesdays to help feed the hungry. When Shirley retired, I decided that this was a job I could do. So every Tuesday after I finished teaching at Schaumburg High School, on my way home, I pulled in the parking lot, went downstairs, and got everything ready for the people that came in to put together and serve the meal on Wednesdays. As years went by and my health issues increased, I felt it was time for me to retire from running the soup kettle. So in 2003, I stepped down from the cooking details and the supervision of the people that came to work. But I stayed on in other capacities, namely securing resources, planning menus, and doing whatever else had to be done, a lot of meetings that I went to. Then my health issues increased, and I felt it was time for me to step down once again. Though, this time I found something amazing. There were people here, part of our faith community, that were willing to step forward and help lighten my load. Mary Hill volunteered to come in on Wednesdays, put the meal together, supervise the shifts of people that came to serve, and clean up. And she's done a wonderful job. I couldn't have continued without her. Bonnie Turk began to come every Wednesday morning, and she and I and Mary Hill would do all the prep work, lay everything out for the people that came Wednesday afternoon. Paul Turk was there to help with his truck to pick up food from Northern Illinois Food Bank, and also to use his carving skills when called upon. He's a wizard with knives, he really is. And some of you may know, if you've pulled a knife out of the drawer downstairs, they're sharp, thanks to him. Tom Lentz helped us rescue food for our use on Wednesday night. And Sherry Lentz and Mary Hewitt were always ready to help us unload food that came from Northern Illinois Food Bank. So I didn't have to do all the work by myself anymore. I could just plan menus, type them up, procure the food that was necessary, and attend meetings that are required from NIFB. The years continue to go by, and I know that my health issues aren't going to go away. So, after 27 years of providing meals for those in need, I will be retiring at the end of this year from my present position. I'm hoping that there is somebody in our faith community that would be interested in taking over my position. I'll work with that person so that the transition will go smoothly and this wonderful ministry can continue to serve the hungry. Anyone who's interested can contact me or one of the pastors. So I want to thank you for the opportunity that I've had. Thank you.
I told Carl we could have someone succeed him, but we'd never replace him. We now invite Kathy Juergens to come forward for our service of farewell. In Paul's letter to the Corinthians, he says, "Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. And so we gather here each week as the body of Christ. Thus, as members of one body, anything that happens to one of us happens to all of us."
I'm going to start by saying this is a tough thing to do. As many of you know, I'm not good with goodbyes, and so, but this one is especially tough. So, Kathy, change happens in many ways and means different things for each of us. Life is a continual cycle of meetings and farewells. And so today, we pause to say goodbye and God bless you to Kathy. She will be leaving Elgin for a wonderful opportunity and moving to Sedalia, Missouri, wherever that is, to begin her ministry with Emmanuel United Church of Christ.
By the way, I'll lose it later. Okay. We are aware that it's... Oh, good.
I was pulling one from my pocket for you.
We're aware that as Kathy moves away from our area, she will leave a portion of herself behind. We give thanks to God for her faithfulness to this church and for the ways in which she served God amid this congregation. And I want to say what a joy it has been to watch her over these years grow and blossom, not only into a pastor, but into a beautiful woman of God and disciple of Jesus Christ.
Yes. Kathy has preached. She's assisted in worship. She's participated in the way. She served on the ministry of youth and young adults. She taught junior high ministry, and she taught junior high Sunday school, assisted with confirmation, was on the Ministry of Worship and Hospitality. She helped with Frog Friday, and I don't know, I know I left some things out. She participated in the life of this church.
To put it mildly, she has been a valued part of this church, and so we want to express our love for her as she leaves this congregation.
We wish her Godspeed and she begins this new chapter of her life.
We're also aware that Kathy takes with her a portion of First Congregational Church in all the ways that we have touched and influenced her life. She will take with her faith she has built, the friendship she's made, and the memories that we have shared. And I want to tell you one thing, that when she went to preach her candidacy sermon in Sedalia, that somebody there said to her, please go back to your church and say, we'll take good care of her. So, yeah, that's when I lost it.
It's
you now.
Go ahead.
So it is indeed our prayer that Kathy will be blessed by her new faith community in Missouri. And may you have a wonderful faith journey together.
It's difficult to say goodbye to loved ones. And so instead, we say Godspeed. May God go with you as you begin your new journey. And now, Kathy,
may God bless you
and keep you.
May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you.
May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace
this day and always.
Amen. All right, at this time we can dismiss the children to their Sunday school classes.
Today's first reading, Exodus chapter 4, verse 10 through 15, page 50 in the Pew Bible, page 63 in the large print. But Moses said to the Lord, O my Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor even now that you have spoken to your servant. But I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. Then the Lord said to him, Who gives speech to mortals? Who makes them mute or deaf, seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what you are to speak. But he said, O my Lord, please send someone else. Then the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses, and he said, What of your brother Aaron, the Levite? I know that he can speak fluently. Even now he is coming out to meet you, and when he sees you, his heart will be glad. You shall speak to him and put the words in his mouth, and I will be with your mouth and with his mouth, and will teach you what you shall do. Today's second reading, Luke chapter 14, verse 12 through 24, page 952 in the Pew Bible, page 94 in large print. He said also to the one who had invited him, When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. One of the dinner guests, on hearing this, said to him, Blessed is anyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then Jesus said to him, Someone gave a great dinner and invited many. At the time of the dinner, he sent his slave to say to those who had been invited, Come, for everything is ready now. But they, all alike, began to make excuses. The first said to him, I have bought a piece of land, and I must go out and see it. please accept my regrets. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going to try them out. Please accept my regrets. Another said, I have been just married and therefore I cannot come. So the slave returned and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and said to his slave, go out at once into the streets and lanes of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. And the slave said, sir, what you ordered has been done, and there is still room. Then the master said to the slave, go out into the roads and lanes and compel people to come in so that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those who were invited will taste my dinner.
That was absolutely beautiful. I don't think we appreciate our choir enough. Wow, thank you. Well, we are now 17 days into the new year. In some ways it seems like it's longer than that. In other ways it seems like New Year's was only yesterday. So I'm not going to ask you if you made resolutions or, worse yet, if you are keeping those resolutions you've made. In fact, statistics say only 45% of the people make resolutions, and Only 68% of the people who made those resolutions are still keeping them 3 weeks out. And worse yet, only 8% keep them all year long. So, I don't know about you, but I can always find reasons for not making resolutions, or if I do make them, for not keeping them. Oh, you know, I'd like to, but, you know, or I want to, but, you know, it seems like our buts, that is B-U-T-S, are always getting in the way of us doing things. When our women's group met last spring and we were looking at some passages of scripture about Jesus calling the disciples and calling people to follow, we noted that sometimes the followers just dropped everything immediately, like Simon, Peter, and Andrew, and took off and left their nets and followed Jesus. And then there were others who made excuses like Moses or like Aaron the man today with who had the banquet and all the people who said they couldn't come for various reasons, like, I want to go out and see my property I just bought, or I want to check out my oxen, or, you know, I just got married, so I can't come. Lots and lots of excuses. The problem is that too often our buts just get in the way. When we were in Bible study, I said that, and we all chuckled. And at that moment, my sermon title was born. And it lay dormant until this moment when I could use it. I loved it. When our buts get in the way. God has heard all of our excuses, going all the way back to Moses, who was arguing with God about his ministry, saying, Lord, you know, I can't speak. I don't speak fluently, and I wouldn't know what to say. And furthermore, I really don't want to do it. Could you please just send someone else? And then God says, you know, do you not trust me to be with you, to help you? But then God said, okay, we'll use Aaron, and you'll speak to him for me. You know, God doesn't want to take our buts. The scriptures tell us that having our buts get in the way is not a new problem, so we can make excuses and say, yep, that's the way it's always been. Or we can say, I'm not going to let my butt get in the way. This is a new year. This is a new chapter in my life, and it's not too late to quit making excuses and instead become more faithful disciples. Jesus tells us that we, that's you and me, we are the light of the world. In this season of Epiphany, we talk about the light of the world, the light that has come into the world. And we are called also to be the light, to let our light shine before others, that they might see our good deeds and then be called to glorify God. Isn't it awesome to think that because of something I did or I said, someone might be called to glorify God? We all have that opportunity. You know, on Christmas Eve, we celebrate Jesus as the light of the world, and probably my favorite moment of that service is when we light the candles, and you see that light spread throughout the whole sanctuary as it moves back, and then we all have that light. I wonder if you realize that the reason we do it isn't just because it's a beautiful tradition as we light candles and sing Silent Night, but that the reason we do it is because we celebrate the light that has come into the world, and then that light has been given to us to carry out into the world. We are now the bearers of that light. Each one of us is called to push back the darkness in our world, in our homes, in our jobs, in the grocery line, in our friendships, and in our acquaintances. so we can begin a new year remembering that each day we are called to carry that light wherever we find ourselves. We aren't called to be Christians just on Sunday morning or when it's convenient, but we're called as we leave the doors of this sanctuary to take that light with us out into the world and use it in our daily interactions as we work to get our butts out of the way. We can replace them with our yeses. Yes, God. Yes, God, I want to make you the main thing in my life. We've been talking for a number of years about living the six marks of discipleship. And we had them on the front of our weekly window for a while, and now they've been gone. And so I think it's important to be reminded of them from time to time. And that's what I'm going to do today. Maybe with our butts out of the way, we're able to focus our attention on them and really, really look at how we might improve our discipleship, you and me. Those six marks, you'll remember, spell out the acronym POWR SURGE, P-W-R-S-R-G. Pray daily, worship weekly, read the Bible daily, serve in and beyond the church, relate with others for spiritual growth, and give of your time, your talent, and your treasures. So I'm going to begin with P, pray. I'm going to suggest that we all begin our days with a very simple prayer. As you open your eyes, say, Lord, please use me to bring peace and joy and hope to all the people I see today. Continue to pray throughout the day. Pray for your children, your spouse, your friends, your neighbors, your coworkers, those that are a little challenging. Prayer might help you with them. The people in the grocery line or in the car next to you who seem extremely impatient. Last Thursday, as I was walking with a group of women over to EPH for lunch after our study group, we heard an ambulance siren. Lori Powell said, wait a minute. I pray for the person who needs that ambulance. It was quick, it was simple, but it was powerful. Lori said, you know, when I hear a siren, I pray for all those who are affected by the need of an ambulance or fire or police. It's a simple thing to do. She said, I also include a prayer of gratitude that those I love are safe. It brings light into the darkness. It's what we're called to do. Early Christians prayed the Lord's Prayer three times a day. You know, we say it rotely, but if we stop and we really think about the words, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, takes the focus off of me, 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 which I often get stuck on during the day, and it puts the focus on God. It's not about what I want, but it's about what God wants to use me for. Maybe you'll consider adding that practice to your daily life and pray it with meaning. Then there's W, worship. In Old English, it really means worth-ship. What do we give value to in our lives? What do we find worthy of our praise? We gather weekly to worship our God because we have found that we can't be Lone Ranger Christians. We gather together week in and week out, and it helps us fine-tune our discipleship. A few years ago, I shared a statistic that is still true. It takes 17 Sundays to establish a habit of weekly worship, and it only takes 3 Sundays to break it. I challenge you. And I'm thinking, I'm preaching to the choir as I look at you because you're here on such a cold day. But I challenge you to make the commitment to worship weekly and then to invite others to be a part of this, to carve this time out of your day, out of your week, to be here in gratitude for all the things that God has done for us. And then there's R, read the Bible. I know this might be the most challenging. You know, where do we find the time to do that? I might suggest you put the Bible in your bathroom. Or maybe you carry it around in your back pocket, a little pocket Bible. Maybe in your purse. Or if you're like me, maybe you have the Bible app. And when you're sitting and waiting, frustrated, you know, look at it. Open it up. Read a passage of scripture. For me, I'm better if I have a devotional to use. And so I would suggest there are many books out there, great devotional books that you can pick up. But I have a devotional emailed to me every day. And it's a great way for me to begin my day. And it comes from the United Church of Christ. It's ucc.org, daily devotional. And they email it to you. And it just helps you to begin your day and to focus your day. So I would challenge you to find a way to read your Bibles each day. Then we come to serve. Serve. Many of you have already mastered this one quite well because you are good at serving God through serving others. Whether you're serving in our food pantry or you are listening to people's woes in your customer service job, or you're cleaning plates off the table at the soup kettle, or you're handing out groceries for the food for Greater Elgin, or you're bringing groceries that will be used for the Martin Luther King food drive and Feed the Hungry here in Elgin. Or you're teaching a child, or building a Habitat for Humanity house, or you're repairing someone's car, or checking in a guest at Pads, or raising money for the Boys and Girls Club, or volunteering at Administer Justice, or, you know, I am always interested in the many ways that our congregation serves. Pastor Adam Hamilton had hopped into a cab, and the cabbie asked him, "So what are you doing in the city?" And he said, "Well, I'm here going to a conference for pastors." And the cabbie said, "Oh, I love pastors." At first, Hamilton wasn't sure if that was said with sarcasm or not. But then the driver proceeded to tell him that he was a follower of Jesus. And Adam said, "Oh, that's great." And then he thought, "Okay, we've got those pleasantries out of the way. Now I can work on my sermon." And so he flips open his laptop, and the driver notices that he's not into conversation. And so he turns on the radio, but it doesn't have music on it. It's actually playing an audio recording of the book of Jeremiah. The driver looks through the rearview mirror to see Adam's reaction, and then Adam sensed, seems like he wants to talk more. So he closed the laptop and he said, tell me, what's your name?" He said, "Emmanuel." "Emmanuel," thought Adam. When someone has the name Emmanuel, Adam thought, it must mean I should listen to him. For those of you who don't know, Emmanuel means God is with us. So he said, "Emmanuel, tell me about yourself." Emmanuel responded, "Well, I am from Ghana, and I am so blessed to be here, and I'm even more blessed to have this cab and to be a cab driver. You know, I love this job because I can bring light to people's lives as I drive them around, and I can share the joy of having Jesus in my life. This is the best job because I get to be the bringer of light." Serving God wherever you are, whether it's as a cab driver or as a judge or as a truck driver, or I can go around the room, wherever you are, God calls us and uses us to bring light into the world. And then we have R, relate to others for spiritual growth. In our busy society, I'm going to tell you, I think this is one of the hardest. It's hard to find that time to carve out for a small group, but it certainly helps to keep us on track when we have a group with whom we're accountable and who can support us along the way. Maybe, if you look at your calendars closely, you can find 2 hours a week to attend The Way or Life Keys, or you can attend the 9:15 Sunday morning Breakfast with the Bible, or the Thursday morning Bible study class. And if those don't work for you, then let us know. We'd be glad to set up a Bible study or a study group at another time that fits your need. Talk to us about it. Let us know of your interest. And then finally, G, which is give. Give generously to God. Many of you are various generous givers, and I have to tell you, I was blown away by our Christmas Eve offering. If you haven't heard, we collected 8,100 and something. And that money is 100% of that is used for the homeless here in our own community, who, by golly, really need a place to stay on a night like last night. And it's used to resettle refugees. Like Carl talked about, we have a history of helping refugees, whether it's the Laotians or those who are now needing to be resettled. And so our money will go to help those who are homeless. January is not the best month to talk about giving. Our personal budgets feel stretched, very stretched after the holidays, and boy, I know that. Yet need still exists, and church budgets still need to be met. You know, printed on our money are the words, "In God we trust." But as we hang on to that money, I wonder if we don't react more like, "In money we trust." You know, I thought it was very interesting that the family from Tennessee that won $328 million this week said they don't plan to let the money change their lives. Boy, I pray that that will be true, because I know how hard that will be. They said they plan to be at work on Monday, working in a warehouse, working in a doctor's office. And they didn't know what they wanted to do with their winnings yet, but one of the things they said is, "We plan to give a portion of it to our church." Wow, I'd like to be that church. 10% of that, let's see, that's $32 million. Wow, what we could do with $32 million. Giving God our tithes should come before all other things that pull at our purse strings. The world around us tells us that it's not about buying more stuff. You know, we save for the latest and greatest gadget, and I have to tell you, I'm as guilty as anyone about this. I love my iPhone 6. But then we finally get it, and we discover that it really, it's nice. Don't know that it's much different than my iPhone 4, but, you know, it's nice. But how much more satisfying is it to give to something that has a lasting effect? Your weekly offerings to the church allow us to minister to our congregation and to our community. About 5 years ago, when Gene Roethlisberger was moderator of our congregation, and we were trying to raise more money for our budget, she challenged each giving unit to consider giving $14 more a week. And that sounded like a lot of money. But then she went on to say, you know what? That would mean giving up a Starbucks coffee a couple times a week, maybe a few times a week, depending on what you buy. And it was a reminder of how we can find money for the things that are important to us. As you examine how you might give more to God, maybe you want to look at giving up something, knowing that it will make a difference. So, surged with power from God, P-W-R-S-R-G, power surge, as we pray, worship, read the Bible, serve, relate to others, and give. We are empowered to push our butts aside and give ourselves freely over to God with no reservations. Every interaction we have is an opportunity to live as a Christian. This year, we're called to go deeper, to more authentically live our faith every minute of every day. It begins with listening for God's still speaking voice and then praying, Lord, I really want to be all you have called me to be. I give my life to you. Are you willing to do that? To get your butts out of the way? So you can say without excuse, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I will follow you. Amen. I invite you to find this blue paper in your bulletin. And you'll notice it's titled Getting Our Butts, and B-U-T-S, I want to make sure you know it's B-U-T-S, out of the way. On it, I have the morning prayer that I suggested, and then I have listed those six marks of discipleship as just a reminder for you, and I've listed that prayer of commitment. I invite you to keep this paper, stick it on your refrigerator, fold it up and keep it in your wallet, as just a reminder of making a new commitment in a new year to really focus on your discipleship. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I invite you to pray with me and then to pray silently. Let us pray. Oh God, may this be the year when we truly get our butts out of the way, when we stop making excuses and start following you. Nothing more, nothing less, and nothing else. Amen. Please join me in our prayer of dedication. We are grateful, gracious God, for the gift of belonging to you. We see the hurts, the poverty, the injustice, and the violence that mars your world, and we know that your heart is broken. We thank you for the high calling to care, respond, and give, to meet the needs and ease the suffering of people you love so much. We pray that these offerings will be useful to fulfill the mission of your church. Amen.
I invite you to take the hand of your neighbor. As you go out into the world, as you go through those doors, I remind you that your challenge is to bring the light out into the world. And it's said in our hymn, if you follow and love, you'll learn the mystery of what you were meant to do and be. And may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace this day and always. Amen.